It's an honor for me as presenter of the Meet the Author series of the Brussels Privacy Hub to have with me in another session in our series, to have with me Dr. Philip Hacker from Humboldt University, Berlin, who wrote a very interesting academic article in the Common Market Law Review on, let's say, artificial intelligence and the consequence for discrimination and non-discrimination law, and also discussing privacy law, data protection. Dr. Hacker, one of the issues you raised in your paper was about artificial intelligence, AI, and biases. You claimed that as a result of artificial intelligence, biases would grow, which is not necessarily good for individuals' fundamental rights. Could you explain that, Dr. Hacker?
It's a statement that certainly needs to be qualified. I mean, there are a number of studies, an increasing number of studies, in fact, that show that artificial intelligence techniques, such as machine learning, can lead to discriminatory outcomes. Now, at the same time, it is clear that it very much depends on how the model, the algorithmic model, is built. You can, of course, try to, and you can actually do that, you can work non-discrimination principles into the mechanism of the model. However, that is not always done. So the interesting thing about AI is, I believe, that in contrast to human decision-making, we can actually consciously choose the design parameters. So if it's poorly done, then it will lead to more discrimination. If it's rightly done, it can actually reduce discrimination, and the task of the law is to incentivize behavior toward the latter, toward the reduction of discrimination, I believe.
Dr. Hacker, recently I had the privilege to be at a conference given by Professor Leenaerts, President of the Court of Justice, who claimed that one of the most intrusive things for fundamental rights at this moment is profiling. Profiling as the main consequence of this new digital society. What do you think about this?
Well, first of all, profiling is a term that I do not particularly like. It is very vague, and it conjures up all kinds of fears and dangers that to a certain extent are true, but also need to be qualified. So just as with AI processes in general and machine learning, obviously profiling can be good or bad. Depends on who does it, with what purposes, and in what way, right? So there is a clear link, yes, you're right, between profiling and discrimination. If it's not rightly done, for example, in the COMPASS algorithm that predicts recidivism of offenders. If it's not rightly done, then erroneous predictions based on profiling can lead to discrimination. In the COMPASS case, for example, it has been shown that the algorithm is wrong more often with black than with white defendants in terms of flagging them as more dangerous than they really are. So that is a problem with profiling and also with artificial intelligence or machine learning tasks in general, but you always have to look at it at the concrete profile and how it is done and to what end. So in the end, I believe we need to make profiling work for society in the way that is compliant with the general principles of the data protection, general data protection regulation, and that is the big challenge for enforcement.
This is a nice bridge to the regulatory aspects of this all. It's an academic, it's a legal article you wrote. You also mentioned non-discrimination principles. How does that relate to the notion of fairness, which is at the core of data protection?
Right. So I believe that there is a direct link, a clear link between fairness and non-discrimination. Actually, if you look in the GDPR in Recital 71, there is a direct link in the text between the two notions. And fairness under the Data Protection Directive was often understood as transparency, right? But now we have two separate principles, principle of fairness and the principle of transparency. So fairness needs to be something beyond transparency. And I believe that in this, we have to turn to behavior that to a certain extent is inappropriate, constitutes inappropriate treatment that does not violate specific data protection duties, such as, for example, behavior or outcomes that discriminate against certain groups, or you could also think of manipulation of certain individuals. And that builds a bridge toward other, say, sectors of EU law, such as anti-discrimination law or the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive.
Okay. You think that transparency was one of the other core parts you already mentioned of data protection law is a right way to ensure non-discrimination?
That is a bit complicated, I believe. So transparency, as we know, is ensured, for example, in Article 15, Article 13, 14 also of the GDPR. One of the provisions talks about the logic involved that needs to be somehow disclosed. Now, it is unclear what that means. If it does mean, but that is unclear, if it does mean that the most important relevant factors for decision making have to be disclosed, and if, on the other hand, this was to be made relevant in anti-discrimination law, then this could be really an important provision. However, I believe that as a matter of the text of the GDPR and the doctrine of anti-discrimination law, it's both not so much the case. So what I would suggest is that we need transparency of training data, of the data that is used to train the machine learning algorithms. We need documentation duties that go beyond what is in the GDPR at the moment, and we need to construe Article 15, paragraph 1, number H, in a way that where it talks about information about consequences of automated decision making, this should also include consequences of bias, of discrimination, for example, the disclosure of aggregate statistics between different groups so that people can actually know whether there is discrimination in the process or not.
Okay, thank you very much. One last question is about enforcement. We all know that in the area of data protection, we have this strong, even data protection authorities, which are even much stronger under the GDPR. In non-discrimination law, there's also national authorities enforcing, but they don't have these strong powers. Do you think there's a way that they could be better to work together, or that we can find synergies between what all these authorities are doing?
Yeah, I think there should be a lot of exchange, first of all, of thoughts and concepts. Clearly, when we think about integrating non-discrimination principles into the GDPR, we need to import some of the conceptual refinement of anti-discrimination law. Not every discrimination is illegal. They can be justified to a certain extent. So this kind of knowledge and that kind of sort of thinking about it needs to be integrated within data protection authorities as well. So there needs to be some kind of intellectual exchange. I also believe there should be strong institutional links, perhaps even to the extent that we could build up some kind of digital agency that takes care of different, say, challenges of the digital agenda under the law. I believe that that could be a way forward because we could hire specialized people, experts in machine learning, for example, that could work on these tasks together.
Dr. Hacker, this was a very interesting interview. We are very grateful that you wanted to come here to Brussels to participate in this event of the Brussels Privacy Hub. Thank you very much. I have here with me Paul Nemitz from the European Commission, who works a lot with artificial intelligence and fundamental rights. Paul, there were many enforcement agencies created in the course of the last years within the scope of EU law dealing with the digital society. Do you think they should work better together? And is there any scope for further synergies between these authorities?
In EU law, a number of different institutions have been created to enforce EU law in the member states. If you think about telecommunications, there are telecom regulators, there's banking regulation, there is equal opportunities law, there is data protection. All of this has specific institutions, and there is indeed scope to reflect on whether between all these different institutions there are synergies from working together, and maybe we can even think about merging some of these institutions in the future to reach higher efficiency in enforcement of EU law.
I have here with me my colleague from the VUB and from the Brussels Privacy Hub, Gloria González-Fuster, whom I will ask a question about the relation between privacy law, data protection law and non-discrimination. Gloria, do you think that fairness, the notion of fairness, is a good way to protect people against discrimination?
So fairness, indeed, it's a very important question for data protection. What it's also important to know is that fairness, as we understand it in general, is not exactly the same as fairness for data protection law. I think that's a key point. If we want to use data protection to fight discrimination, we have to make sure that we use the terms in a right way. There is an sort of unfair processing that can happen in terms of data protection, but it would not be directly related to discrimination. There are mechanisms in data protection law that help us fight against discrimination, like the rules or the processing of special categories of data, and we could perhaps use those in connection with fairness to fight discrimination.